as you think about energy metabolism, it's helpful to think about the big picture first. So the idea of just of energy. There are many forms of energy, right? There's wind, solar, hydroelectric from the cascading water, and of course, chemical energy. Now, when you think about chemical energy, a lot of people think about oil, and it is a big source of chemical energy, but we have other sources. We have wood, we have food. So chemical energy is just energy that's stored in the bonds of chemical compounds. When it comes to food, we have carbon, hydrogen bonds. That's where we're going to store our energy. And the more carbon hydrogen bonds there are, the more energy that's there. This is a fat molecule, and we know that fat has the most calories per gram. It has 9 calories per gram. And if we compare that to our protein molecule, here's an amino acid. This is glucose, so this is a carbohydrate molecule. And here's alcohol. This is ethanol, so it's an alcohol molecule. They have fewer calories per gram. Carbohydrate and protein have 4 calories per gram. And alcohol has 7 calories per gram. And the reason why they have fewer is because they have fewer carbon-hydrogen bonds. Now, if we're going to take that energy that's in that carbon-hydrogen bond, we're going to use it to do the energy pathways of the body. Think about how we're going to do that. We first think about uncontrolled release, just release all that energy. Well, if we have uncontrolled release of chemical energy and wood, we have fire, and that heat is the dispersion of that energy. We could think about that in humans as well. Maybe you've heard of the idea of spontaneous human combustion, where the body just burns up all its energy. Now, that's part of an urban legend. There is no evidence that it ever occurred. But I sometimes like to have students think about that, because then we realize that we don't have uncontrolled release of energy. We have controlled release of energy. So let's think about how the body is going to control that and look at those steps. Overall, we have 2 basic steps of how the body takes food energy and then can get it in a way that we can actually spend it for the body. And what we're going to do is we're going to take this first step, and the first step is to release the energy in the carbon-hydrogen bond. And we're going to capture it in a special molecule called adenosine triphosphate, or ATP. So we've got our food, and we've got those carbohydrates, fats, protein, alcohol, or energy-yielding nutrients, and we're going to consume it. And of course, we've got to digest it, we've got to absorb it, we've got to get it to their basic molecules of the fatty acids, the amino acids, the glucose, and alcohol. But once we get it into a cell, we're going to rip that carbon hydrogen apart. And so we're going to end up here with our waste products that are based on carbon and hydrogen. But look what's happened. We've added oxygen to it. So we end up with carbon dioxide and water. So that means we've got to add oxygen to this pathways. And of course, we need it. If we don't have oxygen, we're going to die very, very quickly. And so that's what's going to happen. Now, we do lose some heat. Right? In this process, we will lose some heat. It's why your body produces heat. But not all of it. Some of that energy that's released from that carbon-hydrogen bond will be captured in this ATP. I want to look at this molecule specifically. So look over here. This is adenosine triphosphate. We can see adenosine is just kind of the backbone. And then we've got these 3 phosphates, and we're going to call them mono, di for 2, and then tri. So that is adding these phosphate molecules. And what we have here is that we will have ADP, and really that's just given. I've listed it here. It's just in the body, so our body will have ATP around. They also will have a phosphate around, so we've just got that in the body. And then we're going to take that and form this ATP. So that is another chemical bond, and that is going to capture in that bond. We're going to capture some of that energy, capture energy that's released when we break that carbon hydrogen bond. Now, we could stop there, but that's not it. We're going to go spend it. In fact, ATP is considered the energy body's energy currency. So we're going to spend it. If this is step one, where we actually produce ATP, then step two is where we're going to spend it. We're going to take that ATP and we're going to release that energy in that third bond and bring it back down to ADP plus phosphate. So this is step two. And that is where we're going to take that energy and we're going to spend it. We're going to spend it on just metabolism of life, exercise, growth, your beating heart, your thinking, your breathing. All of those things take energy. So that's step two. We transfer it to power that body's all the energy that a body needs. Now, when you look at that, I think sometimes when students are first learning this, they're kind of like, no, wait a minute. If we just took this, this carbon hydrogen bond and to power the, why can't we just go directly to the energy in that carbon hydrogen bond to the power of the body? Why go through this molecule of ATP in the middle? But that's what our body does. So that's where we're going to leave it. The idea, and actually it's an ingenious system, because now the body can actually just regulate one molecule. It only has to deal with regulating ATP. And so we can monitor how much ATP. Again, we only have about 5 seconds worth of ATP at any one time. So that's what's going to happen. Step one, we're going to create ATP by breaking that energy, releasing that energy from the carbon hydrogen bond, and then we're going to capture some of that on that ATP. And then step two is we're going to spend it. And that's how the big picture of how we control the release of energy from our food and then use it to power our body.